But let's begin with this morning's call to worship in honor of Mother's Day. Happy are those who find wisdom and who get understanding, for her income is better than silver, and her revenue better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called happy.
We come today seeking wisdom. If we seek wisdom, she will come to us. Come, wisdom, come to us today.
And now here's a song in honor of Mother's Day. Happy the home when God is there. Pray with me this morning's prayer for illumination. O God, tell us what we need to hear, and show us what we ought to do to obey Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning's gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10. And we will read first 20 verses. Hear the word of the Lord. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, "Peace to this house." If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, "The kingdom of God is near you." But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them, "The kingdom of God is near you." But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, "Even the dust of your town that sticks to our feet, we wipe off against you." Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God is near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon than the judgment at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted up to the skies? No, you will go down to the depths. He who listens to you listens to me. He who rejects you rejects me. But he who rejects me rejects him who sent me. The 72 returned with joy and said, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." He replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now I have a video I'd like to play, and it's a Gaither video. It's not actually the Gaithers, but it's on their program, and this song is "I Heard My Savior Calling Me." Hi, Jen. Happy Mother's Day. Welcome to you all.
God bless you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you all.
There was a great revival in our little country church. People came from miles around to hear about God's word. I learned it in the spirit. You could feel it in the air. My life was changed that night as I bowed my head in prayer. I heard my Savior
calling me.
On that blessed night, I fell down on my knees. Well, I raised my hand to Jesus, pure faith has set me free.
Oh, praise God.
Praise God, I've seen the light, my Savior's calling me. I'm so thankful for a Savior who would make the sacrifice. In a selfless, loving gesture, giving us eternal life. It's an offer for the taking, listen with an open heart. It's a choice that's up to you, hear the Savior calling too.
God,
I've seen the light, my Savior's calling me. I heard my Savior
calling me.
On that blessed night, I fell down on my knees.
God.
Praise God, I've seen the light, my Savior's calling me. Oh, praise God, I've seen the light,
I've heard my Savior calling me.
God, I hear my Savior calling me. Amen. Amen. Let's go before the Lord in prayer now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Second scripture lesson for today comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 1, beginning with verse 9. Hear the word of the Lord. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, "Write on a scroll what you see, and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea." I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As I said earlier, our current sermon series is called Experiencing the Resurrection. And it's exciting for me, at least in my book, and I think maybe in some of your books as well. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is one of the verses that we've been using as a key throughout this series. Paul writes, "If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised." And Henry and Melvin Blackaby, who wrote this book that I'm preaching from, described the resurrection as an invitation to experience the living Christ in your life. And during this series, we've talked about several topics, including the reality of sin, the reality of our choices, and the consequences of our choices. We've talked about the Father's eternal plan, the fact that Jesus died because of our sin, and the reality of salvation, the fact that Jesus did rise from the dead. And the Blackabies remind us how important the cross and the resurrection are to the believer. They say, when we talk of the cross, we're looking at something much larger than the wooden timber that Jesus was nailed to on that fateful day. It's more than the nails, more than that crown of thorns, and more than the tomb. Likewise, when we talk of the resurrection, we're looking at something more than a stone rolled away, empty burial wraps, and an angel's proclamation. As I said a couple weeks ago, we have been offered a pardon for our sins. Have you accepted it yet? God doesn't make anyone accept or reject him. He steers us in his direction. But the decision is entirely up to you. It is your choice. However, we do not get to choose the consequences of those choices. God does. If we believe Scripture, if we believe God, then we believe that Jesus Christ is life and gives us life. No one can take that life away. As we take our final breath here on earth, we will have the hope and promise of a resurrected new life. The cathedral in Milan, Italy, is awesome. It's the second largest Gothic cathedral in the world. I should show you a picture sometime. Look it up online. But on the arches above a triple doorway are three inscriptions. The one on the right reads, "All that pleases is but for a moment." The inscription on the left reads, "All that troubles is but for a moment." And above the center door are these words, "Nothing is important save that which is eternal." And oh, what truths those inscriptions hold. I mean, all that pleases is but for a moment. And all that troubles is but for a moment. Nothing is important save that which is eternal. Eternity is forever. Life on earth here is temporary at best, but eternity awaits us all. And I know that's a big thought, it's a scary thought really when you think about it, but we sometimes think that we have a long life to live here ahead of us, but in reality it's just a blink of an eye. Tragically, many people rarely think about eternity, much less prepare for it. Nevertheless, whether we prepare for it or not, all of us will face eternity, and one day we'll realize the consequences of our choices and our preparation for eternity, or lack thereof, if we're not prepared. And when the truth about eternity is so readily available, why do so many people avoid it? Because it isn't what they want to hear. Many people just don't want to hear the truth about God, and so they don't try to find out. We're afraid that God might tell us what to do, right? Or what not to do, right? There was a teacher who got caught up in a business scheme in which she invested her entire life savings. And she was new to such investments. She didn't know much about it, but she was talked into it by a smooth-tongued broker who promised certain riches. And then when the deal fell apart and the woman lost all her money, she contacted the Better Business Bureau. It didn't take them long to help her see that it was all a scam from the very beginning. And they asked the woman, "Why didn't you come to us earlier? Why didn't you seek our advice first?" She dropped her head and replied, "I thought about it, but I was afraid you'd tell me not to do it." See, the cost for her reluctance to hear the truth was her entire life savings. And you know, we pastors often hear similar things. People rarely come to us for advice beforehand. We usually hear about the damage and destruction that results from some unwise action. And when we ask, "Why didn't you come ask or come to me first or ask some advice?" the response often is, "I was afraid you'd tell me not to do it." And if they don't actually say that, that answer is at least usually implied, you know, if you can feel it. Well, the Bible is telling the truth about Jesus being the only way to eternal life. Paul tells us this in 1 Timothy chapter 2. He says, "There is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Because Christ has been resurrected from the dead into new life, he is the only one through whom we can also be resurrected and go to heaven." The resurrection of Jesus really is unique among all religions in the world. Every religious leader who has ever walked this earth has died and is still dead to this day. Jesus alone has been resurrected from the dead. Not resurrected back to life, I'm sorry, not resuscitated back to life, but resurrected into new life. And if Jesus had not been raised, he would be nothing more than any other good religious teacher to come along before or since. In fact, as Paul tells us, if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. We must keep in mind that Jesus came from eternity. He stepped into time and space and lived on this earth to communicate the truth about eternal life and to provide our safe passage into it. Because his perspective on life and death is much different than ours. Not only did he step into time and space, he created time and space from eternity. So he has a totally different perspective on all of this. And as we explained in an earlier message, what we see as death, Christ considers to be sleep. He didn't come and die as a man to save us from sleep, but to deliver us from death, which is eternal separation from God. Because we will all sleep, saints and sinners, believers and doubters alike, but we will not all die. Not if we hear the truth and accept his pardon. The most important thing about Christ's death and resurrection was not physical death. It was spiritual. See, he both slept and died. He was physically dead, and he was spiritually dead. For the wages of sin is death, and all of our sin was placed upon him. Spiritual separation from the Heavenly Father is what he experienced in our place. So, what am I saying? We need to hear the truth to live forever? Well, yes. How do we do that? By reading, hearing, and obeying God's word. And Jesus is the word, and he is the truth. Therefore, the word is truth, and the truth is in the word. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. And he is the only way to eternity. He is the truth that sets us free. He is the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in him shall never die. He is the reality of eternity. But you say, believers die all the time. I was at a funeral last week. I don't quite understand what you're telling me. Well, Christ's focus is eternity. His priority was not life on earth. He told us some good ways to live on earth, but his priority, his focus was eternity. Living forever is what his death and resurrection accomplished. The Bible says that having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Jesus came from eternity, and he will bring all those who believe in him to eternity. The resurrection demonstrated that death could not hold him in the grave, nor did it have power over him. And because he is eternal, this eternal nature is given to all who are in Christ. The resurrection was not for earthly salvation, but it was for eternal salvation. And we must realize, however, that this promised power of the resurrection applies only to those who believe and obey him. Eternity certainly awaits everybody. We're all going to experience eternity. But new life is only for those who obey. The other side of eternal life is eternal judgment. We read about that in Hebrews chapter 6. You know, some will enjoy eternal life while others are going to have to endure eternal death. That's what it comes down to. And Jesus often talked about the reality of eternity for believers and non-believers alike. One example is his parable of the sheep and the goats from Matthew 25. There he says that the Son of Man will judge all the nations. To some he will say, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. To others he'll say, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Finally, Jesus clarifies and leaves no question about what he is saying. He says, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So eternal life and eternal death really refer to the two kingdoms that we read about in Scripture. One is the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of light. The other is the kingdom of Satan, or the kingdom of darkness. And we can be in the light or in the dark, but never in both. So every human being is born into the kingdom of darkness due to the fall of man in the Garden of Eden and the sins of Adam and Eve. And it was there that Eve believed the lie that Satan told her and then ate the forbidden fruit and convinced Adam to do so as well. Because of this action, evil is alive and well in this world, whether we like it or not. And one of Satan's favorite weapons to use against us is half-truth. He used this weapon to deceive Eve by asking, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." See, this weapon of half-truth makes us think something is true because it seems believable. But in reality, it is anything but the truth. And this weapon is used against Christians all the time. As I said earlier, the truth comes from God and is found in His Word and through His Word, Jesus Christ. In Ephesians, Paul speaks of a real battle that Christians are involved in, which is spiritual warfare. I know about that. Ephesians 6 says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." Well, evil is definitely at work and vying for each one of our souls. Satan wants more warriors in the kingdom of darkness. He wants us to forget to walk in the path of God or in the path of light. If we walk in the path of darkness, we will live in such a way that we rarely have any thoughts about God. And that is exactly what Satan wants. Now, these half-truths lead us into sin, which in turn leads us into separation from God. God takes sin seriously and will not allow it into the perfect place that we call heaven. He cannot. We need to be cleansed of all that sin before we can possibly go to heaven. And Jesus is the only one who can cleanse us. Because of the resurrection, spiritual warfare, which is a real battle, has been won by Jesus Christ. And this is why it's important for us to live in Christ and to follow God's will for our lives. There are several verses in Romans 5 that speak of this very well. I'm going to read just part of it from the New Living Translation. It does a very good job of providing a clear understanding of what the writer of Romans was trying to say. It says, "But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, He will certainly save us from God's judgment. For since we were restored to friendship with God by the death of His Son, while we were still His enemies, we will certainly be delivered from eternal punishment by His life. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, all because of what our Lord Jesus Christ has done for us in making us friends of God. When Adam sinned, sin entered the entire human race. Adam's sin brought death, so death spread to everyone, for everyone sinned. Yes, people sinned even before the law was given, and though there was no law to break, since it had not yet been given, they all died anyway, even though they did not disobey an explicit commandment of God as Adam did." What a contrast between Adam and Christ, who was yet to come. And what a difference between our sin and God's generous gift of forgiveness. For this one man, Adam, brought death to many through his sin. But this other man, Jesus Christ, brought forgiveness to many through God's bountiful gift. And the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation. But we have the free gift of being accepted by God. And even though we are guilty of many sins, the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over us. But all who receive God's wonderful, gracious gift of righteousness will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. Yes, Adam's one sin brought condemnation upon everyone, but Christ's one act of righteousness makes all people right in God's sight and gives them life. Because one person disobeyed God, many people became sinners. But because one other person obeyed God, many people will be made right in God's sight. God's law was given so that all people could see how sinful they were. But as people sinned more and more, God's wonderful kindness became more abundant. So just as sin ruled over people and brought them to death, now God's wonderful kindness rules instead, giving us right standing with God and resulting in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. In other words, being born again allows us to leave the kingdom of darkness and enter that kingdom of light. Peter, in 1 Peter 2, tells us, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light." Don't you want to leave the world of darkness and join the world of light? It's easy. It's a choice. Choose Jesus. You know, somewhere along the line, humanity just got its priorities backwards. We began living for the here and now, and not for eternity. And I don't have to remind you that eternity is forever, which is much longer than we will ever be here on earth. So we need to get our priorities straight. As we read, Jesus, when sending out 72 of his followers to preach and teach, he made sure that his followers kept eternity in their sight. They went out in Jesus' name and witnessed the impossible. But Jesus kept it in perspective by saying, "However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." And these words are a reminder that we are not to be distracted by things of the world, such as success, accomplishments, and good works, to name a few, money, and many other things. Instead, rejoice in the fact that your name is written in the book of life in heaven. God has chosen you. God has blessed you. God is working through you. There's nothing better. Our joy should be found in doing exactly what God has called us to do, first and foremost, which is to be in a constant relationship with him. And the Blackabies say that being a Christian does not mean trying to live a good life, trying to be better than everyone else, striving to perform certain church rituals or believing the right doctrines. It means a relationship with the risen Lord. It means living the new life he provided through the resurrection. That reality impacts every area of our lives. And if we are lucky, it will impact the lives of others who know us. Because the resurrection changes everything. It changes the way we do life. Life on earth is short. So focus on eternity and secure your soul for eternal life, because in spite of what we sometimes hear, that was the priority of Jesus. Is it yours? In the name of Christ, amen. Amen. So experiencing the resurrection is living with power that helps us overcome sin and have new life that we can share with others and live in eternity when we pass from here. And so we're going to finish with a wonderful song. It's called Christ is Alive. It's a nice video from a church with a big pipe organ and an orchestra. Hope you love it.
Thank you. Girls, open the books.